Hi everyone, welcome to CSC 260 Computer Science Honors B. Today we will go over the Blackboard and the course information, administrative information for the course. And I basically will want to start the first lab, which basically covers a summary of CSC 160 from last semester. So the starting point for all of you is probably Blackboard, and on Blackboard you will find a link to the course website, a link to Piazza, the class information from Solar. This class will be totally online this semester, and I will record every single lecture and post it on Piazza and also on YouTube, so you can see it after the lecture. So both the class and the lab are posted in Blackboard, and you're right, it actually starts at 4:25. I didn't notice that. Thank you very much. In the course documents, I will put the labs, and as I said today, there will be three labs that cover different topics in CSC 160. Most important, basically it's the first problem for printing distinct numbers is to actually get you back into having an editor like Eclipse to edit your programs and run them. The timing execution is a very important program that you need to execute this semester for most of the data structure problems. Basically, we'll sort big arrays of 1 billion elements, and we want to time the execution of different sorting algorithms. Then there is a tic-tac-toe game. The good thing about games, they are computationally intensive and they have a logic that needs to be implemented. And finally, you have to implement a problem of the problem of Collant's conjecture, an unsolved problem in mathematics, and you have to return the number of iterations until you actually return the correct value. And you can use a static array list to actually remember the sequence that you want to return, that you will find to return from the Collant's conjecture. I posted a few more labs. Labs 2 and 3 are on generics, and those are topics that I will cover later this semester. There will be assignments in this class. So as I said, basically the labs will be in course documents. They are only value 3 points, and I will go over the syllabus next. But in assignments, there will be actually assignments for the class. Every 2 weeks, we'll have an assignment, in total about 7 assignments. The Piazza for the class was shared with everybody in the, on Blackboard, and you can sign up to the Piazza by clicking on the link that you find on Blackboard in announcements. Also in announcements, you will find other information like the Stony Brook Computer Science Clubs, a message from the Women in Computer Science with the official website, Facebook group, and similarly for Stony Brook Computing Society and the Game Developers Club. So on Piazza, we'll post the recordings for all the lectures. You will find pinned to the top the course website and the syllabus that we'll discuss today. The office hours, we have multiple TAs, Connor, Brandon, Yufeng Chen, Garrett Chen, Ratana Archivara, our TAs that you already know from last semester, and my information for office hours. I will probably have to move a little bit office hours since actually our class starts at 4:25. The Google Meet for the class is also linked on that webpage and is used for both the class and the office hours for everyone. My office hours, my TA's office hours, and the class. Then the course website is linked from the main webpage for the class. You will find there the course description, the staff information, the class time and place. You will find the same Google Meet link posted everywhere for lectures, for labs, and for office hours. And then you will find lecture notes for the entire semester, except towards the end, I will have lecture notes on functional programming, but we'll start first with generics and data structures. Will cover lists, stacks, queues, priority queues, in Java. Then we will implement them. You will cover sets and maps. We'll cover collections and aggregates in Java 8 and further. Then we'll talk about developing efficient algorithms, the big O notation, both for time and space. Then we'll have sorting, implementation of list stacks, queues, and priority queues, binary search trees, AVL trees, hashing, graphs, weighted graphs, B-trees, red-black trees, and then we'll cover principles of programming languages like functional programming, and also towards the end, basically we'll talk about binding and the execution of a compiler on a stack. Those are new topics in this course, and the lecture notes are still developed. The rest of the lecture notes are available now on the course website. Also, on the same website, you can find the syllabus for the class, and I will talk about the syllabus next. So let's actually move to the lecture notes for today. So hi, everyone. Welcome to our CSC 260, Computer Science B. It's a continuation of our class CSC 160 from last semester. Basically, it's a second part of the two-semester sequence, CSC 160 and 260. In this case, we apply object-oriented programming techniques to data storage and manipulation, basically data structures, such as complex data sets, such as binary trees, heaps, priority queues, balanced trees, and graphs. We will use recursive programming quite heavily for all the programs that we are going to discuss. Towards the end of the semester, you will see graph algorithms like Dijkstra and Lloyd Floyd that are basically using recursive programming heavily. We'll talk about sorting and searching algorithms. We'll examine the efficiency of these algorithms. We'll talk about the big O notation, the growth rate for algorithms. Intermediate level programming languages concepts will be covered next. There are two textbooks of this class. The first one is the continuation of the first textbook that we used in CSC 160. But then we'll talk about principles of programming languages, and we'll use the Michael Scott textbook, Programming Languages Pragmatics. So we'll talk about functional programming mainly, but then we'll also have lectures on type systems, data abstraction, and modularity. The description that we just discussed is in the Stony Brook Bulletin for undergraduate students. The prerequisites is CSC 160. I checked already, all the 35 students in this class already took the CSC 160 with me. The co-requisite for this class is CSC 261 for 1 credit. This class, the course lecture, is 3 credits. So in total, both classes, 260 and 261, will be 4 credits. The course outcomes agreed by all the faculty that teach this course are an ability to define and use complex data structures and use them in large-scale software development, an understanding of the importance of time and memory efficiency. As I said, we'll talk about growth rate and the big O notation. We'll talk about linear, log linear, quadratic algorithms, an understanding of programming languages paradigms. So towards the end of the semester, we'll actually have a course on programming languages, principles, and trade-offs, and an understanding of functional techniques. So we'll talk about functional programming, and we'll program in functional languages. By the way, anytime you have a question, please just ask. I made sure to increase the sound, so if you actually want to ask a question, you can ask a question either by unmuting yourself or by posting it in the chat. And from time to time, I will check the chat. Good. So my information is that I'm Paul Fodor. My office is in 214 New Computer Science Building. I don't know if we will see each other in person this semester unless the situation with the pandemic changes. But I'm actually in my office, and I will teach from my office. My office hours will be on Google Meet, and the link is the same link that we use for the class, for the office hours, for the labs, and for the TA's office hours. My phone number is 631-632-9820, also is my office phone number. Most of the communication in this class will be done through Piazza. I enable private messaging, but if you want to send me a message, please do so at this email, paul.fodor@stonybrook.edu. In fact, the reason why I actually joined earlier than I was planning for was that I got an email from Adit that this class already started. Please include CSA260 in the subject email and I will respond immediately. The TAs for this class will be posted and actually have been posted on Piazza, and Blackboard will be used for assignments, grades, and course material. Basically, we'll use Blackboard for assignments and grading because you will have access to your own grades only, and that's required by FERPA regulations, Federal Education Privacy Act. And the rest is basically communication through Blackboard and through the public website for this class. The class time and place is actually correctly posted here. It's Mondays and Wednesdays, 4:25 to 5:45 p.m. on Google Meet. And the labs follow the lecture and also on Google Meet. So there are two textbooks that will follow closely for this class. First, we will cover basically data structures and a little bit more about efficiency of algorithms, and we'll use the same textbook that we use for CSC 160. Basically, Introduction to Java Programming by Daniel Young, 11th edition, published in 2017. And we'll start with chapter 19 on generics. And we'll continue with data structures first in Java, then how to implement these data structures, and then efficiency of algorithms and more complex data structures. Then for the second part of the course, the equivalent of CSA 216, we'll cover principles of programming languages, and we'll use the Michael Scott textbook from Rochester on programming language pragmatics. And we'll cover about the first five, six chapters. The grading schema for this class is the following. It's similar to the grading schema that we had last semester, but is now adjusted to the requirements of 160 and 260 updated last year. We'll have the homework assignments, 25% of the grade, quizzes, 5% of the grade. We'll have these quizzes similar to labs, kind of. They will basically be programming or questions, questionnaire that must be solved by the end of the day of the lecture. And I will post them on Piazza prior to the class. And basically, you can solve it by the end of the day. The labs are 10% of the grade. And then we'll have the three exams. All of them will use Lockdown Browser with monitoring. So you already have the experience from last semester. 20% each. The exams will be as follows. First exam will be on September 30, not in classroom, but during the class time, 120 minutes. Let me actually update this because we can't meet in a classroom yet. So we'll do it on a Lockdown Browser. The second exam will be on November 4th. And the final exam is set by the university schedule on December 9th, 8:30 to 10:30. All exams are 120 minutes. The pass no credit option is not available this semester. From what I know, please watch registrar announcements if this changes. But for the moment, it's a little bit different than last semester. Last semester, this was allowed because we were caught by the pandemic during the semester, but now we all know our situation and basically we'll follow the university requirements for this. The cutoffs for the grade are similar to those that we used last semester and standard for kind of standard for the college. A are 90 to 100, A minus 90 to 95 to 100 is A minus is 90 to 95, B plus is 87 to 90, B is 83 to 87, B minus is 80 to 83, and so on. The C's are from 70 to 80, the D's are from 60 to 70, and anything below 60 is an F. The special rule, so basically it's the grading says that is the best of two worlds. Basically, first it says that if you get above 90, for instance, you are guaranteed that you will get at least an A. But then if the average of the class is below the minimum for a C, which is 73, then all the scale will be adjusted with that number of points that basically a C is guaranteed to have. So the special rule basically states this, that if all your grades, including the homework assignments, quizzes, recitation, and all the three exam grades are above the class average, you are guaranteed to receive a grade of C or higher in this class. Since this is an honors class, usually the case is that many of the students will actually get higher grades because not of the special rule, but because you will basically do all assignments and get good grades. There will be extra credit problems as part of quizzes and homework assignments, but which amount to at least to less than 4% of the final grade. So at most one letter grade is that extra credit assignment. And usually they are basically things that to develop a GUI for a certain homework assignment. So things that basically you have to use the knowledge that you already learned in previous class or previous classes to implement something that we do in this class. There will be in-class quizzes. So these are these quizzes that will be posted usually with Google Forms, and you will have to solve it by the end of the day. And they are valued those 5% of the grade that you saw in the grading schema. Now, one thing that always I say it at any class that I teach is that the final grade that you receive in this class will reflect as far as possible the extent to which you have mastered the concepts and their applications. And how much someone needs a grade or how close they are to the next letter grade will have no effect on the grade. As the instructor of this class, I want everyone to do well in this course and will make every reasonable effort to help you understand the material taught. However, the grade that you receive at the end of the semester are final, except for rare situations involving grading errors. So they will be not be altered for reasons as described above, that someone needs a better grade or they are close to the higher, to the next level. If it's not above or equal with that level, then it's not. There is no reason to change the grade. The homework assignments are due on fixed dates and times, and no later submission is permitted. And all assignments must be submitted via Blackboard. There will be lab exercises like the ones that I posted today that require a solution during the day of the lab because we are all online these days. I will post the lecture notes and actually the video of the lecture as soon as we finish the lecture. Attendance is mandatory if you want the credit. And basically, what this means is that you must submit the lab and we will grade it from Blackboard. And basically, zero means that you don't have a submission, and three means that the programs are correct and the lab was submitted. And I can tell you, basically, it's binary grading most of the time. That zero if you didn't submit and three if you submitted and it's correct. For regrading, this semester, you are taking a lot of courses and I'm also teaching four times the students that I usually teach, actually more than that, in fact. So I have a request for regrading. Please see a grading TA, any one of the TAs or myself, within a week from the day that the grades are posted and emailed and announced on Piazza. So basically, I will send an email through Piazza that your grades are available on Blackboard, either for exams or for homeworks. And if you have a regrading request, you have to see us during office hours for the following week. And I will have two sets of office hours. My TAs will all have two sets of office hours by the end of the week. So this is the current schedule. Is basically tentative, and I will basically develop new lectures and new topics as the semester evolves. But we'll cover generics this week. Then next week we'll cover list stacks, queues, priority queues in Java. The following week we'll cover sets and maps in Java, and then we'll start discussing about efficiency of algorithms and the Big O notation. We'll talk about the different kind of algorithms: linear, log linear, quadratic, exponential. We'll talk about sorting algorithms, and we'll analyze their efficiency. We'll implement lists, stacks, queues, and priority queues. Then we'll talk about binary search trees, AVL trees, hashing, graphs and applications, weighted graphs, B-trees, and we'll finish the semester with functional programming and other principles of programming languages topics. If you have a disability, physical, psychological, medical, or learning disability, please contact the SACS office, previously called the DSS office, at that phone number. If you are planning to take an exam, usually these days I will actually put a special rule that you will get extra time based on what are their recommendation as part of the exam, basically settings. So all this is confidential, and if you want, basically I will be notified through the SACS office about such cases and what accommodations to give. Academic integrity. The following rules are posted in every course at Stony Brook. Each student must pursue his or her academic goals honestly and be personally accountable for all submitted work. Representing another person's work as your own is always wrong, and any suspected instance of academic dishonesty will be reported to academic judiciary. This is the university requirement. For more comprehensive information on academic integrity, including categories of academic dishonesty, please refer to the Academic Judiciary website. And I will go over these in the next slides. Basically, you can discuss general assignment concepts with other students, like how to use tools, what are the requirements, but you may not share assignments, source code, or other answers by copying, retyping, looking at, or supplying files. And we check these assignments with tools like Moss from Stanford that basically detect even code that we would not detect manually, like, for instance, changing names or changing some of the workflow of the program. These tools actually do a good job to trigger and tell us if such cheating occurred. And by the university requirements, we will have to bring you up to academic dishonesty charges. So let's talk about the different kinds of academic dishonesty. Unpermitted collaboration. Unless the instructor has explicitly approved working together, students should assume for their own protection that is not permitted. So if a homework is individual homework, and I see two submissions that are the same, even if you tell me that you work together, that was not allowed. Basically, for individual assignments, you can't work together. Unpermitted collaboration is not allowed. Helping somebody else to plagiarize from one's own homework. For example, by giving someone else a copy of your homework or doing it for them, it's basically wrong. And that includes public repositories on GitHub. This has happened in the past. A student would put the homework before the deadline on GitHub. After the deadline is okay. Before the deadline, you can't share your homework because anyone on the web can actually take it. And this actually happened a student just had a public repository, was putting the homeworks there, and another student would take them and submit them as his own. And both students were basically brought to academic dishonesty charges. Representing somebody else's, so this is the other part of the coin, when somebody else claims that the homework that they didn't do are their own. And again, that's a standard example of cheating. Buying or selling source code, there are websites that actually claim to do the homework for you if you pay them. That's not allowed in a class that teaches computer science. And using source code from the web without properly citing. So for instance, if an assignment is to implement an AVL3, do it yourself from the lecture notes or the textbook as instructed. Don't just Google it. So the instructor in such cases of academic dishonesty makes a recommendation to judiciary office, and the computer science department policy is that cheating is cheating, no matter what amount of cheating has occurred is a cheating. We don't wait for the second homework that is copied or something like that. We just, the moment that we get a homework that is copied, we report it. Do not cheat. In fact, you are cheating yourself. You will not learn programming if you just copy. Our job is to teach the material and make sure that you learn it. And part of that is to check if you actually learn it and if you do the homeworks. And the computer science recommendation, the department recommendation is F for cheating. So basically, if there isn't, the instructor makes a recommendation to the academic dishonesty office. And if the academic, basically, if that recommendation for computer science is F. If you go through a catastrophic event like a major illness, death in the family, please contact me as fast as possible or the college office, the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences, to get back on track. And the reason is that once you start running late, it's really hard to catch up. In most cases, you can't catch up unless basically you try to formulate a plan of how to actually catch up. And this is very important now with the COVID situation. Now, what do you need to get started? Start from Blackboard. I assume that all of you still have Java installed on your computer from last semester, Eclipse IDE. Again, learn the debugger. You will debug a lot of code as you did last semester. And every even number exercise solution is actually available on the course website. And you can basically download it to take a look at the problems, learn from other people's examples. So the software that you need for this class is the same that you need last semester, Java Development Kit and Eclipse. Initially, I wanted to cover Python this semester, but due to the whole pandemic situation, I was not able to actually do the entire course in Python. And beside that, Java makes a comeback. So recently it has grown in use, and I assume that most of the software that will be developed will still be developed with JDK 8, but in future semesters, if I can basically do prior to the semester, the lecture notes, I will cover this in Python. Please be on time, show respect to your classmates. Don't disturb the lecture unless you have questions related to the lecture and which are welcome. Welcome and enjoy the class. So let's see if there are any questions. Yes, quizzes will be posted on Piazza as soon as, basically before the class, and they will be available up to the end of the day. Labs are due at midnight, like before. Yes, you can submit part of the lab. So the way that I always develop the labs is that I want to basically keep you engaged in programming. The whole point of programming is practice. You need to practice as much as you can to know programming. So usually the truth is that my labs are actually, they take longer than just 1.5 hours, 1 hour and 20 minutes. So be prepared that you will basically have labs that will take you 4, 5, 6 hours, 10 hours. So feel free to submit one problem of the lab. It will suffice for the credit for that lab. 3 points, full points will be given for that lab. Okay, any questions? Thank you. So I have here with me today the TAs for the class, and TAs, please announce yourself. If you can also put your video camera so you, the students can see you. I just want to introduce you before we actually go to the lab for the day. And basically, today's lab is really a recap of last semester. So what I want everyone to do actually is to restart implementing problems in Java and start with the lab for today. So Connor, if you are here, please announce yourself and say hi to the whole class.
Hello, hello.
Hi, good. I will also stop the recording now.